So good morning and welcome. Today we are going to discuss about the MOS capacitor. We'll start our discussion on the MOS capacitor. As you know that the MOS capacitor is the heart of a MOS transistor. So the characteristics of MOS capacitor has to be understood properly to easily understand the characteristics of a MOS transistor. Okay. So in this class we will particularly talk about an important parameter of the MOS capacitor, which is called flat band voltage. Okay. I will introduce the concept of flat band voltage, and then I will discuss how to compute the flat band voltage in MOS capacitor. Okay. So here we go. We'll start with a hypothetical structure. Okay. Where the both gate and the substrate are made of the same material. Okay. In a MOS capacitor, you know that there are three layers. Okay. Please try to join the class in time. Okay. All of you. Please try to join the class in time. Okay. So I was telling about a hypothetical structure. Okay, so we'll start with this structure where we'll have three layers. Okay, the first layer is again it says, let's say, semiconductor, and the second region is a oxide, and the third region is again a semiconductor. So let's say that this gate is made of semiconductor, and the substrate is again a semiconductor. Okay. And also note that the two are made of the same semiconductor material with equal doping. Let's say that the silicon is used here for the substrate. So gate is again used for similar kind of, if this is a crystalline silicon, so the gate is again a kind of crystalline silicon. Okay. And for the time being, let us consider that the gate terminal. Okay. So the terminal out of this gate region must be known as the gate terminal. Okay. So the gate terminal is connected with the substrate terminal by the same material. Okay, so gate and the substrate both are connected with let's say crystalline silicon wire. Okay, all right. So the gate terminal is here, and let's say that this is our substrate terminal. Okay, so gate and the substrate contact must be here. So substrate contact again we can consider is made of the silicon, and then the gate region and the substrate region is connected by a wire which is again made of let's say silicon. and it's again a polycrystalline silicon. So the three materials used for the gate region here, semiconductor, and the contact between these two, all are silicon. The same material, silicon material, is used for these three regions. Okay. So what will happen as a result if we try to investigate the contact potential? When let's say that someone moves from this point one to point two. Okay. If someone moves from let's say semiconductor, someone moves from the gate region to the substrate region. Okay. So what will be the contact potential in that case? As we have already discussed that if there is a stacking of many regions, okay, many materials are similar material with slightly modified doping level, you can say. So if there are a number of materials connected back to back, they may be similar material or different material, and then when we try to compute the contact potential drop between these two points, between point 1 to 2. So what we do, if let's say that the work function of the first region is phi m1 and the work function of the last region is phi mn, so the contact potential turns out to be phi mn minus phi m1. We have already discussed this. Okay, so we can use this concept here, since you can see the gate region is made of semiconductor with let's say the work function phi s, and the substrate is also made of the semiconductor and with the same work function phi s. Okay, then the contact potential when we move from point 1 to point 2, or when we move from this region, from the gate region to the substrate region, then we'll see that there is no contact potential built up, because all the three regions are made of the same material, so their work function are same, Fermi levels are aligned for the gate region and for the contact region as well as for the substrate region. So because of this, you will see that the contact potential, the contact drop when I move from this gate region to the substrate region turns out to be phi s, the work function of the substrate, minus the phi s, the work function of the gate region, which turns out to be zero. Okay, and at the same time I am also considering that there is no charge present in this oxide region. We just consider an ideal situation where gate and semiconductor were made of the same material. In between we had let's say silicon dioxide, and the silicon dioxide interface is perfect, so there is no trap charges, no interface charges present at this silicon dioxide interface. It is free from the interface charges. So under this condition, you will see that the contact potential moving from the gate region to the substrate region turns out to be zero, and as a result you will see that there is no charge present in this structure, hypothetical structure. Okay, no charge accumulation, no charge piling up, there will not be any hole or electrons seen. Okay, and because of this phi s minus phi s equal to zero, so no potential built up, no electric field, no charges, this structure is free from any kind of charge piling up or accumulation or inversion or depletion, because this is a kind of ideal structure where both गेट एंड सेमीकंडक्टर इज मेड ऑफ सेम मटेरियल. ओके, बट इन ए प्रैक्टिकल केस द गेट एंड द सेमीकंडक्टर्स आर मेड ऑफ डिफरेंट मटेरियल्स आर द मटेरियल सेम मटेरियल विथ डिफरेंट प्रॉपर्टी. फॉर एग्जाम्पल इन ए सिंपल मॉस कैपेसिटर, ओके, द थ्री रीजन्स आर बेसिकली द मेटल रीजन, ऑक्साइड रीजन एंड द सेमी कंडक्टर रीजन. सो द थ्री रीजन्स आर द मेटल रीजन, द टॉप रीजन इज द मेटल रीजन, देन द ऑक्साइड रीजन and the semiconductor region. So let us say that this is our gate contact, and there will be here a substrate. To take out the substrate contact, there must be a metal region here, and from the substrate a body contact must be coming out. Okay, so gate contact, this terminal is being referred here as a gate contact, and this terminal is being referred as a body contact. Okay, and this region is basically semiconductor. So this is this could be silicon. Okay, this could be this is a semiconductor, which could be silicon or some other semiconductor material. Okay, then if this is a silicon, then this should be, let's say, SiO2. For in case of other semiconductor, this could be another dielectric material. This could be a high k dielectric material or something else. Okay, this region is typically a metal region. Okay, the first MOSFET which was fabricated, so there this region was made of aluminium metal. Okay, it was made of aluminium, and that's why this name became popular: metal oxide and semiconductor. Okay, later on this metal was replaced by polysilicon to achieve certain to simplify the fabrication process, you can say. So the metal region was replaced by the polysilicon, but the polysilicon is, as you know, is polycrystalline layer. So the semiconductor here, the substrate, is basically a single crystal. That could be a, let's say, 100 oriented silicon crystal, but the polysilicon, which is used as a gate, is a polycrystalline silicon region. Okay, so on the top of that, this gate region, the gate terminal coming out over this gate contact is taken out of this polysilicon region. So even when the polysilicon replaced the metal, the structure was, because of the historical region, used to be called as a metal oxide semiconductor structure, MOS structure. Okay, so what I wanted to point out here, that in a practical MOS capacitor, the gate region is different from that of the semiconductor region. Okay, so gate and silicon may be made of the different material, and if it is so, now let us again sort this gate with the body region. Okay, by a gate contact with body contact with the help of a metallic wire. So let's say that this is a metallic wire. Okay, and if we have connected this, please note here that no external potential is battery is connected between gate and body terminal. Okay, simply what we have done, we have sorted the gate terminal with the body terminal. Okay, and we are again considering here that the interface, silicon silicon dioxide interface or semiconductor oxide interface, is a perfect one with no interfacial charges. Okay, no trapped charges in the gate oxide region, So this interface, silicon-silicon dioxide interface, is basically a perfect interface. Okay. So what will happen? Can we see the charges in the semiconductor in this case? To investigate that, now let us try to find out the contact potential between gate body contact potential. Okay. So to find out the gate body contact potential, someone can move from gate region through this metallic wire to this let's say metal plate to this substrate. Okay. So let's say that now the gate region is having a work function of phi m. Phi m is the work function of gate region. Work function of gate material. Okay, and phi s is a work function of semiconductor. Work function of semiconductor. So in this case, what will be the contact potential when someone moves from gate region to the semiconductor region? What should be the contact potential? This must be work function of the last material minus work function of the first material. Okay, work function of this polysilicon, work function of this semiconductor, which is phi s, minus the work function of this gate metal, which is phi m. Okay, so phi s minus phi m is basically the contact potential draw when someone moves from the polysilicon region to the substrate region. Okay, whether you move through from the through the this metallic wire or you move through this oxide, this potential difference will be observed. Phi s minus phi m is going to be the contact potential drop between the metal and the semiconductor region. Okay, and as I said that the gate region may be made of the different material now with respect to the substrate region. So the phi s may not be equal to phi m in this case. Okay, so if phi s minus phi m, phi s minus phi m is not zero, then you will see that a potential difference will be seen, will be set up in the semiconductor, and because of this some kind of charges will also be generated. Okay, so you will see the two possibility. Either there will be a positive charge piled up near the silicon-silicon dioxide interface, and to counter this, a negative charges will be piled up in the gate region, or vice versa, or the negative charges will be piled up in the semiconductor and the positive charges will be absorbed in the gate region, depending upon the relative value of phi s and phi m. Depending upon the magnitude of phi s and phi m, there could be two possibility. In first case, there will be a positive charges at the silicon-silicon dioxide interface, and there could be positive charges at the silicon-silicon dioxide interface, and to balance them, there must be negative charges in the metal gate region, or there could be negative charges at the silicon-silicon dioxide interface, and to balance them, there could be positive charges in the gate region. Okay, so let us try to investigate if phi s is less than phi m. Okay, let's say that the phi m is greater than phi s, then what is going to happen? If phi m is greater than phi s, then you can just check the polarity of the potential that is established in the semiconductor, And you can also relate the polarity of the charges that will appear as a result. Okay, so let us consider this particular case where phi m is greater than phi s, and if phi m is greater than phi s, just consider. Let us draw the energy band diagram and investigate as we have done in case of contact potential. We are considering that the phi m is greater than phi s. So, if let's say that this is q phi s. Okay, this is the reference energy level. Okay, and this is work function of the semiconductor, the Fermi level of the semiconductor. So this is EFS. Okay, and this is EFM, the work function of the metal layer. And we are considering that Q time phi m is greater than Q time phi s. Okay, so obviously. The electrons will be moving from the semiconductor to metal, and therefore the semiconductor becomes positively charged, metal becomes negatively charged, because the carriers were at the higher energy in the semiconductor and at the lower energy in the metal. So the semiconductor becomes positively charged, and the metal will become receive the negative charge in equal amount. So in case when we have this scenario where phi m is greater than phi s, in that case you will see that the semiconductor become positively charged at the interface. There will be positive charge, and in equal amount there will be negative charge in the gate region. Okay, so this is gate region and the body region. So positive charge and the negative charge, and even still we are considering that the interface is free from the charges. So if this is, then the electric field lines will be established like this, and of course the potential of this semiconductor will be higher than that of the metal. Okay, and you can also consider the another case incidentally, or for the design purpose, it could be the case that phi m is greater than, as we consider here phi m is greater than phi s, there could be another case where phi s could be greater than phi m, and if phi s is greater than phi m, then a reverse situation will appear here, and in that case the semiconductor will have negative charges. Semiconductor silicon dioxide interface, let us call this silicon dioxide interface. Okay, so at silicon dioxide interface there will be negative charges and there will be positive charges in the metal region. So therefore the field direction will actually reverse, the field lines will be emanating from the gate region and will be terminating to the semiconductor, whereas in this particular case where phi m is greater than phi s, the field lines will be emanating from the semiconductor and will be terminating to the negative charges of the gate region. Okay, so now you can see that there is a electric field present here, and because of the electric field, if we try to investigate the bands, if we try to plot the energy bands for this structure, then you see that there must be a band bending to address the issue of to reflect the presence of the electric field in this structure. Okay, so let us take this case only, phi m greater than phi s, and see how we can draw the energy band diagram for this case. Okay, any question, any doubt from anybody, please feel free to ask. Am I audible?
Yes, sir.
So we are considering the case that phi m is greater than phi s. Okay. So if phi m is greater than phi s, then the contact potential is basically negative. Phi s minus phi m is negative. Okay. And we saw that there were positive charges at the silicon dioxide interface, and the negative charges in the semiconductor. So we are dealing with this case. Okay, phi m greater than phi s. So in this case, if we can plot the energy Venn diagram for this MOS capacitor here, okay. I have not shown here gate and body terminal, so sometime I will not shown, okay. It didn't mean that gate and body terminals are not present in the structure, okay. So in this case, when the contacts are made, you can say the contacts are connected together. So the Fermi level of the two sides, metal and semiconductor, will be aligned, okay, perfectly. The Fermi levels will be aligned, okay. And if this is EF, and let's say that the semiconductor that we considered was a P-type, okay. So if this is a P-type semiconductor, let's say that let us draw the three regions here. Okay, this region is reflecting the semiconductor, and the middle region is for oxide, and this region is for the gate. Okay, so essentially here, when I move from bottom to top in this structure, I am moving from right to left in this energy Venn diagram. Okay. So this is basically our silicon-silicon dioxide interface, and this is oxide gate interface, and this region is reflecting the gate region. Okay. So Fermi level in two cases will be aligned because gate is connected with the body. So the Fermi level of the semiconductor is aligned with the Fermi level of the metal region. Okay. We are considering the semiconductor to be p-type, so the Fermi level, EV level here is close to the EFS. So this is our EV layer, and let's say that this is EC layer, okay, which is this gap EC minus EF is much larger than the gap EF minus EV, because we are considering a p-type semiconductor. Okay, now look at this electric field. Okay, you see that the semiconductor is positively charged compared to the gate region. So gate region is negatively charged, you can see. So the energy when I move from the semiconductor towards the gate region, the energy is going up, electronic energy, because it is minus q time v. Okay, and since gate is gate is having negative charge, okay, and if we just see the potential here, so the p-type the semiconductor is at higher potential than the gate region. So therefore, the electronic energy in this metal region, in electronic energy in the gate region, will be higher than that of the energy in this semiconductor. So when we move from the semiconductor side to the metal side, basically the bands will bend upward to show that there is a increment in the energy. Okay, so here is the band bending towards the semiconductor, band bending in upward direction, and if this is the edge of gate region. And you can also see that the field lines are actually going in upward direction from the semiconductor to the oxide region. So again, the same trend of energy will be seen in the oxide region. You can see the top of this oxide, the top of this the conduction layer of the oxide. There will also be a bending because there is an electric field present here. So because of this electric field, there will be bending, and the direction is this, because the gate is at lower potential than the semiconductor, okay, and the two Fermi levels are aligned. So here is a band bending, the bands are bent upward, okay, and this is also well justified, because you can see, as we have already discussed, that this EF minus EV is a measure of the hole concentration in the semiconductor. It's a measure of positive charge carrier in the semiconductor. Okay, and the closure this EF with this EV layer. Okay, the narrower this gap EF minus EV is reflecting, the higher positive charge concentration. Okay, so when we move from the semiconductor, from the bulk of the semiconductor towards this interface, so you will see that this is becoming narrower. It means that it's indication that the density of the positive charge is higher towards the interface. It's higher towards the interface because of these positive charges that have appeared because of the work function difference. Okay, so this narrower gap between EFS and EV close to the silicon dioxide interface is an indication that there is a piling up of the positive charges near the silicon dioxide interface, and the bands will actually bend in this particular fashion. Okay, so similarly, if the other case is considered where phi s is greater than phi m, then again you can draw, you can observe the charges appearance in the semiconductor. You can see the direction of the electric field that will actually reverse case of this case, and therefore you will also see that if you try to plot the energy band diagram, you will see that the bands bent downward in that case. In this case, the bands have actually bent upward. Okay, so in case of phi s minus phi m, the bands will bend downward. Okay, so certainly if phi m is not equal to phi s, then there must be a band bending in the semiconductor. Okay, and the band bending is nothing but its reflection of the presence of the electric field. Okay, so if I have to make the bands flat, then what should I do? Okay, if I have to make the bands flat, if I have to remove all the charges from this MOS capacitor structure, what should I do? Any suggestion from the student side? Let's say that I have to remove the charges, then what should I do? What was the origin? What is the origin of the charges in the semiconductor? What is the main region? The main region is the contact potential drop. When we move from the gate via this metal contact to the semiconductor, we see a potential drop of phi s minus phi m. Am I right? Okay. So if I connect a source here with the potential phi m minus phi s, which is also defined as a phi m s, okay, then what will happen? I have connected a source here which is phi m s. I have connected a battery with potential phi m s, where phi m s is nothing but phi m minus phi s. You see, the contact potential was phi s minus phi m. If and the contact potential was because of the work function difference of the gate region and the semiconductor region. Okay. Now what I have done to neutralize this contact potential, I can connect a battery here, and the battery potential is nothing but is phi m s, which is phi m minus phi s, just equal and opposite of that of the contact potential. You will see that the all charges will be vanished from this structure. Is it or not? Because now the contact potential phi s minus phi m will be neutralized by phi m minus phi s. So in this case, the total the total potential drop when someone moves from the gate region to the semiconductor region, it becomes equal to zero. Okay, so now if there is no charge present in the system, now the band, no electric field in the system, so bands become flat. Okay, so the EC level is it's no more bending upward. Okay, the EC level, now the it becomes flat. Similarly here the EB becomes flat, and this layer, the top of this also becomes flat, okay, because no electric field present in this oxide region. And also the Fermi level will not now be not aligned because of the presence of this electric field, because the presence of this battery 5 ms, the equilibrium is broken, and now the metal Fermi level has gone below this Fermi level by the amount Q time 5 ms. Okay, so now the EFM, the new EFM level must be here, okay, and the EV layer is flat, EC layer is again flat, and top of this the conduction EC layer in the oxide region is also flat, okay. So to make the bands flat, what we need to do, we need to apply a potential which is equal to 5 ms. Okay, so that's why this 5 ms is noted as the flat band voltage for the semiconductor in ideal case. 5 ms equal to 5 m minus 5 s. Okay, sometimes this 5 ms is noted by it is noted by VFB, the flat band voltage. The flat band voltage is equal to 5 m minus 5 s. Okay, so this is the amount of external voltage that is needed to make the bands flat in the MOS capacitor. Okay, is it understood by everybody? Any question from anybody? Please feel free to ask.
हेलो
हेलो
हाँ सर
हाँ प्लीज प्लीज फील फ्री टू आस्क आस्क योर क्वेश्चन
सर यू आर टेलिंग दैट फ्लैट बैंड वोल्टेज इज 5 - 5
यस
बट इट इज when there will be a condition that 5s will be greater than 5 m. If the condition will be
for both cases,
if the condition will be,
I understood your question. I understood your question. Okay. What I want to say is that this is actually 5 ms always. Okay. The flat band voltage is. The flat band voltage VFB is always equal to 5 m minus 5 s. It doesn't matter if 5 m is greater than 5 s or 5 m is less than 5 s. Okay, if 5 m is greater than 5 s, then this flat band voltage become positive. If 5 m is less than 5 s, then the flat band voltage becomes negative. That's all. If 5 m is greater than 5 s, then the contact potential becomes negative, flat band voltage becomes positive, and vice versa.
Okay,
understood.
Got it. Yes.
Any other question from anybody? Okay, so I hope that this made sense. Now we can consider a little bit more practical situation. Okay, so far we have considered that there was only one non-ideality, which was that phi m not equal to phi s. Okay, there could be another case, as I said, that in semiconductor there could be semiconductor interface at silicon-silicon dioxide interface, there could be interface charges. Okay, so this is our semiconductor oxide and the gate. So gate terminal here, body terminal here. Okay, so there could be possibility that there are some non-ideality in the oxide. Okay, you know that the charges may be introduced in the oxide by a number of regions. Okay, one region could be the incomplete ionization of the silicon dioxide. You see that the silicon dioxide, to grow silicon dioxide, the silicon is just exposed to the air and temperature is raised. Okay, so there are two kind of oxidation, wet oxidation and dry oxidation. Okay, so in dry oxidation, dry air is passed, inflow is maintained in the chamber furnace and the temperature is raised. So silicon oxidized and silicon dioxide region is formed. Okay, even in dry oxidation, you see that there will be flow of oxygen inside the chamber. Okay, so what will happen, you see that the silicon has to interact oxygen in order to form SiO2. Okay, but let's say that at the some point of the time, this oxidation process has to stop, so supply of oxygen is may be stopped in the chamber. So in that case, there could be incomplete ionization of the silicon dioxide. So rather than getting SiO2, we can get SiOX, where X is less than 2. So if it is so, then this SiOX actually becomes positive ion. Okay, so this kind of positive charges may be present in the oxide. This is one of the region. The another region could be the non-ideal interfaces. Okay, the interface at the silicon-silicon dioxide interface, you see that there may be interface traps. Those interface traps may be formed because of the dangling bonds, because of the incomplete bonds, incomplete silicon bonds. Okay, so because of incomplete silicon bonds, there could be some traps created at the silicon-silicon dioxide interface, and those traps can capture the charges, positive charges or negative charges. Okay, so there could be some charges because of the interface traps at the silicon-silicon dioxide interface. Okay, another source of the charge in this silicon-silicon dioxide interface is people who are actually handling this sample. You must know that the human body is the source of sodium and potassium ions, means the sweat coming out of the body is basically is rich with sodium and the potassium. So sodium and potassium ion can be trapped inside the silicon-silicon dioxide, in silicon dioxide during the handling of the sample, and some of the positive charges can be introduced in the silicon-silicon dioxide. Okay, apart from that, there could be some trapped charges that could be because of the sample is being operated in a radiation environment, or there could be in a MOSFET there is a hot carrier effect. So there the electrons gain very high energy from the electric field and they interact with the lattice. Okay, there could be impact ionization, lot of electron holes were generated, some of those carriers may enter into the silicon-silicon dioxide in the oxide region. So because of these number of regions, you see there is a possibility that lot of charges may be found in the silicon-silicon dioxide region. In the very beginning, in silicon dioxide region, in oxide region, in the beginning, actually the nature of these charges, when beginning means I am talking about the historical perspective, when people tried to fabricate this MOSFET structures. Basically, they failed because the property of these charges, oxide charges, were not understood properly. And if there are a lot of charges present in the oxide region, then they will not allow to the electric field coming out from the gate terminals to enter into the semiconductor. They will screen the electric field coming out from the gate region. If field will not enter into the semiconductor, then this electric field cannot simply control the semiconductor charge. Okay, so because of this region, you see, since the charges, the oxide charges, were not studied properly in the very beginning, so people were not able to get the MOSFETs structures working properly. Okay, so but now a lot of research has have already happened, and the property of these interface charges are well known, and they can be modeled very easily. So what is done, a number of charges because of the different region could be present in the oxide, but they are modeled in such a way that actually could be helpful for our further analysis of the MOS capacitor. What is done, irrespective of the presence of a variety of charges inside the oxide region, it is assumed that there is a fixed, oxide charges are present near the silicon-silicon dioxide interface, and these are basically the positive charges. Okay, so this is basically our gate region, and the SiO2 region here, and below there is a semiconductor. So at this interface, at semiconductor SiO2 interface, there are fixed positive charges present in the crystal. Okay, at this interface there are fixed positive charges present. Okay, and these charges are basically known as oxide charges, and irrespective of the type of this semiconductor, this semiconductor could be p-type for n type n-FET, n MOSFET, and n-type for a p-MOSFET. Okay, but irrespective of this type of this semiconductor, the oxide charges which are considered at the interface are always positive. So these could be represented by the symbol QO prime, where QO prime is the total interface charge density at silicon-silicon dioxide interface. Okay, this is surface charge density. So the QO prime is coulomb per centimeter square. You can say it's coulomb per centimeter square, and the typical value for a well prepared MOS capacitor, the typical value for QO prime, the oxide charge density, is basically equal to 1.6 in the range of 1.6 into 10 to the power 9 coulomb per centimeter square to 1.6 into 10 to the power minus 8 coulomb per centimeter square. So this is the surface charge density because of the oxide charges present at the interface. Okay, and the density, if we don't convert that into the charge, it turns out to be 10 to the power 10 to 10 to the power 11 ions per centimeter square, and therefore the charges turns out to be 1.6 into 10 to the power minus 9 to 1.6 into 10 to the power minus 8 coulomb per centimeter square. Okay, so now you see that what will happen here, just look at the MOS capacitor. Okay, and in this MOS capacitor, let's say that the phi m was not equal to phi s initially, okay. So phi m was not equal to phi s, so there was charge present, there were charges present in semiconductor and the interface, semiconductor and the gate region, and with help of this phi ms, the external source, those charges were neutralized, so there were no charges. But now we are considering that the silicon-silicon dioxide interface is not pure, there are impurity, there are oxide charges present here, and these oxide charges are positive charges, okay. And if there are positive charges present in at the silicon-silicon dioxide interface, what will happen as a result? There must be equal amount of negative charges present in the system, okay. So some charges, negative charges, will be seen in the semiconductor, and some negative charges will be seen in the gate region, you see. So field lines coming out from these positive charges will be terminating to the negative charges, okay, and something like this, okay. So semiconductor interface has positive charge, both semiconductor and gate region will be negatively charged, okay. So there are field lines here, field lines passing through the oxide region, there are electric field lines also passing through their field lines present in the semiconductor. If field lines are present in the semiconductor, then of course there will be, if we investigate the band diagram, then you will see that there must be band bending in EC and EV level of EC and EV level in the semiconductor for region, okay. So if I have to remove these negative charges from the semiconductor, what should I do? How can someone remove the negative charges from the semiconductor in this case? Any idea, any suggestion from anybody? You can think up about the concept of the charge neutrality, how these field lines can be eliminated, how the charges can be removed from the semiconductor. There is a one way. If I provide sufficient number of negative charges to the gate region, okay, so now the field lines will be coming out from the positive charges, will be terminating to those extra negative charges that are present in the gate region. So if it is so, then these field lines will be disappeared immediately, so these charges will also be disappeared. So now these total positive charges are actually balanced by these negative charges. And please also compare this case with that of when we consider that phi m was greater than phi s. So in that case, the charge was charges were present in the semiconductor, positive charges, and the field lines were emerging from those charges and were terminating to the negative charges of the semiconductor. In this case, the charges are present at the interface only, okay, not in semiconductor. So again, field lines are coming out from these positive charges and terminating at the negative charges of the gate region, okay. So no field lines, the field lines are not present inside the semiconductor, okay. So no band bending will be seen in the semiconductor, no charges will now be observed in the semiconductor, as the total positive charges of the silicon-silicon dioxide interface are counterbalanced by the negative charges of the gate region. And how these negative charges can be supplied? We can simply connect a battery, okay, in this fashion. So if we could connect a battery with the potential equal to minus Q time upon COX, because if you see, if there are Q prime charges present at the interface, okay, and if the COX is this kind of parallel plate capacitor, one side is positively charged, another side is negatively charged, and the charge density at the positive side is Q prime, So if that is divided by the capacitance, what you see that the potential difference is built up. Let's say that this potential difference is psi ox, that is built up across this oxide region. So psi ox is the potential which is equal to qx upon cox, and that is built up into the oxide. So how this potential can be built up, I mean how the charges which were present in the semiconductor can be removed? By applying equal and the negative equal and the opposite potential here, which is equal to qo prime upon cox prime. Okay, so this qo prime upon cox prime will ensure that there are sufficient number of negative charges at in the gate region, and therefore this is the situation. There is no field line in the oxide, so no charge present in the field lines will be only in the oxide region. There will not be field lines in the semiconductor, and therefore the semiconductor becomes neutral, and there will be no band bending in the semiconductor. Only the band bending will be observed in this oxide. Okay, so in this case now, to make the bands flat in the semiconductor, now we need to include, now we have to apply the potential equal to phi ms minus this qo prime divided by cox. Please note it. Okay, so phi ms needed just to counter the work function difference, metal and semiconductor work function difference, and minus qo prime upon cox is needed to provide the sufficient number of the charges so that the positive charges of the interface, silicon silicon dioxide interface, are balanced by the negative charges of the gate region. Okay, so the flat band voltage, now the modified flat band voltage in presence of the fixed charges, in the presence of the oxide charges, can now be modified as VFB equal to phi ms minus qo prime divided by cox. Okay, you can make it cox prime if this is normalized. Capacitance can also be normalized by the area. Okay, so cox prime is basically epsilon ox upon tox. Is it making sense? So we'll discuss this case, we'll see in a little bit more detail, and in next class we'll try to develop the energy band diagram for this MOS capacitor case in presence of the oxide charges, and we'll see how the energy band diagram that we have discussed for the previous case can get modified in order to accommodate the presence of the charges. Okay, so with this we'll finish this today's lecture. If you have any question, any doubt, then please feel free to ask. Okay, we'll continue this in the next class. Anybody, any question?